Hello. Welcome to this session on the history of cinema. In this episode, we'll look at German Expressionism, its historical background, and its chief characteristics. When World War I entered, Germany was gripped by social, economic, and political instability. The country faced riots and anarchy. Inflation, unemployment, and food shortages crippled the economy. Morale hit an all-time low. It was at this time that the German silent movie made its best accomplishments. Perhaps the German people were trying to regain their prestige through their literature, drama, and visual arts. Drama scaled great heights under the master playwrights Bertolt Brecht, Ernst Toller, and Jorge Kaiser. The artists and painters like Max Reinhardt, Lionel Festinger, and Paul Klee created sets using art and light to convey a complex meaning. So let's look at how German cinema differed fundamentally from US cinema. In the USA, Hollywood, which was on the Pacific coast, was separated both geographically and culturally from its centers of art and communication on the East Coast. The conventional artists considered cinema as pedestrian and, of course, low class. So they were hesitant to do any experimentation in cinema. But in Germany, Berlin was the center of all arts. The new visual medium called cinema fascinated the artists, and they were ready to experiment with it. They explored the inner self through cinema to represent not so much the physical reality but the state of mind. Thus, the great German silent movies and the movement called German Expressionism emerged, best represented perhaps by the film The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. The great German silent movies or silents consists of primarily three types: historical fantasy, expressionist films, and Kammerspiel or chamber play films. All these types dealt with the psychology of the characters and contained psychological content. Historical fantasies were historical or mythological films. Its characteristics are architectural settings, careful costuming, romantic lighting, and big crowd scenes. These films evolved from Max Reinhardt's concept of the theater. They do not focus on historical reality. Rather, history is given a psychological and spectacular treatment. It was like a keyhole view of the past, as if the great historical events were seen through a keyhole into a bedroom and as extensions of sexual intrigue. Two films of Ernst Lubitsch, Madame Du Barry, released in 1919 and later retitled Passion, and Anna Boleyn, released in 1920 and later retitled Deception, and Fritz Lang's film Destiny, released in 1921, are good examples for historical fantasies. Some scholars have observed that Cecil B. DeMille may have been indebted to Lubitsch for his film Ten Commandments. Kammerspiel films or chamber play films, this constitute another category. Like historical fantasies, this type of films too evolved from Max Reinhardt's theater. They presented a more realistic atmosphere but with dense psychological content. In most of the films, the characters were from the lower middle class. The decor was sparse, with objects given extraordinary importance. There was unity of time, Place and Action. Paul Leeny's Backstairs, 1921. Liupu Pick's Shattered, also 1921. And F.W. Murnau's Last Laugh, again 1924, are some of the key films that fall in this category. Last Laugh tells the simple story of a doorkeeper in a five-star hotel who is on the verge of losing his job because of his old age. He was a man who appreciated himself on the way he dressed as a dignified doorkeeper, receiving respect from his neighbors. One day he is demoted as a washroom assistant. He fears loss of face among his fellow people and steals his old uniform, puts it on and goes on to pretend he is still the mighty doorkeeper. But his worst dreams come true when he is found out and humiliated by the neighbors. The twist in the tale comes when a lonely millionaire breathes his last in his arms. According to the millionaire's will, all his money was to be given to the last person who is with him when he dies. The poor ex-doorkeeper thus becomes a millionaire. The film ends showing his luxurious life at the same hotel. The positioning of the camera in the film is interesting. Often it takes a subjective position, showing what the subject sees. For instance, what the doorkeeper sees. When it takes an objective position, the camera goes into the smallest details, like a novelist setting the scene. In the early part of the film, the camera is placed at a low angle to show how the protagonist views himself as somebody who matters and how he looks upon others. From the moment he is demoted, the camera moves to high angle, showing how pitifully vulnerable he is. The next category of importance is street film. This is a subcategory of commercial or chamber play films in which the street plays an important part. Joyless Street, 1925, by Jorge Willem Pabst, is an example coming under this category. We move on to German Expressionism. Though only a part of the great German silent movies, Expressionism commanded the whole acclaim for German cinema of the period. Expressionist movies, especially Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, became synonymous with German cinema. Like the historical fantasies, the Expressionist movies were also set in the past and less specific as to time. The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari was directed by Robert Wayne, and the story was written by Karl Mayer and Hans Janowitz. This he is doing. He tries to tell everyone in vain about Caligari's deeds. When his lover's life is in danger and after the death of his friend, Francis becomes successful in convincing a group who manages to unearth the reality behind Caligari. But finally, it turns out that all these were the hallucinations of a mentally ill person in an asylum where Dr. Caligari, who is depicted as the villain, is the director. And that the girl he considers is his love is a co-inmate. In order to create the world and hallucinations of a madman, the sets were designed artificially. Sets were constructed from wood, plaster and canvas. The fears of the madman derived not only from the people and events, but also the shapes of naturescape, the town, the fairground and even the mental asylum. For that, the trees were created like barbed spears, pools like black shadows, streets like maze. Ramps and stairs were foreshortened and houses looked like geometrical blocks. Since the directors at the time were not much technically competent in lighting, the shadows and light were painted to gain better control. Another good example for an expressionist film is Nosferatu, 1922, directed by F.W. Murnau. Nosferatu is a vampire by night, like Dracula. and Count Orlok, a real person by day. For the film, Murnau selected real exteriors like deserted castles, towns with lots of pointed roofs and narrow twisting streets, rocky roads with abrupt inclines and turns and deformed trees. He uses techniques like fast motion to show the movement of the vampire's vehicle, negative imagery to show the frightful journey to the castle, superimposing and stop motion. Many studies have been conducted on the Expressionist movie, especially about Caligari, describing these films as representing a brutal and irrational society. One such study by Siegfried Krokow opines that the film is a premonition of the rise of Adolf Hitler and Nazism. Let's look at some of the important characteristics of Expressionist films briefly. One, the camera moves to follow a subject or to show what the subject sees or to probe into a character using low and high angles. The camera becomes a narrative tool. Two, lighting is carefully used to reflect the mood of a character and the mood of the scene. Lighting supplements the film. The directors understood that by illuminating some areas more than others, which is called key lighting, one can make the place the center of attraction. In The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, the director and set designers were less confident about handling light effectively and thus painted the shades and shadows. But in Nosferatu, original light and shades were confidently used to set the mood. There is a shot in which the gigantic Nosferatu is shown standing on the edge of a boat with his shadow reaching down to the hull of the boat. Three, set designs is very important in these films. By creating barbed sphere-like trees, maze-like streets and so on, the films convey the inner world and fears of the characters. Four, performance style too was important. The actors worked on their characters in such a way that they would reveal the character even by a nod or by a movement of their eyes. Five, these films had elaborate and detailed scripts. For D.W. Griffith, there were no scripts at all. But the German directors wrote elaborate scripts to describe the positioning of a light or a shadow. Now, let's summarize what we have been looking at in the history of cinema. Though pioneering filmmakers like the Lumiere brothers and E.S. Potter had laid the foundations for the medium and technology of cinema, it took a while for cinema to acquire its distinctive visual grammar and aesthetics. It was perhaps D.W. Griffith, the American filmmaker, who first thought about the grammar of cinema. With different kinds of shots and camera angles, he tried to add more meaning to his art. However, European countries like Germany, France and the Soviet Union played important roles in developing the grammar further. Like language, cinema too has a distinctive grammar, a set of rules of visual composition to convey the meaning appropriately. The position of the camera, the types of shots and their duration or length, the camera angle, etc. are the main components of the grammar of cinema. German Expressionism was a movement that contributed significantly to world cinema. So here are some assignments for you. Assignment number one, compare Nosferatu and The Last Love. Assignment number two, prepare a review of The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. And the last assignment, write a short note on Leni Riefenstahl. And here is some reference for you. With this, we come to the end of this episode on the history of world cinema on German Expressionism. We'll soon be meeting again for another episode of this history of world cinema.